Let's pray. Father, we thank you so much for being our Lord and Savior, Lord. And we pray that you will help us submit to your Lordship. Calling you, Lord, is not just a name, Lord, but it's a position that you hold as Lord of our lives. You bring us many great and wonderful things, Lord. You bless us with your word. You bless us even more greatly with your salvation through Jesus. And we thank you and love you and praise you for that, Father. And today as we look at your word, Lord, we pray that it will have strong implications for our life because your word is our handbook. It's our guideline. We sing a song, I'm using my Bible for a roadmap. What an excellent idea each day to find comfort and strength in your word. And so we look to it today, Lord, to lift you up and to lift us up and bring us a freshness about everything that we say and do as we walk each day with you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Today, obviously, Chris isn't here, so you're stuck with me. He's good to us. I'm blessed.
But you're doing it.
I did not want to interrupt the flow of Chris's teaching in the book of James. So we're going to deviate from that today, and we're going to talk about something a little different that the Lord's put on my heart. So that when Chris comes back, we haven't lost the continuity of his excellent teaching. We are so blessed to have him. We want to look at a simple word today that's very common in our language. So many of the old biblical terms that we use as Christians have fallen out of common use in our everyday language these days in modern times. But this one remains. And it's a word called perseverance. We need perseverance in our lives for a number of reasons, and we're going to look into that. Our key verse here comes from 1 Corinthians 15, verse 58. Therefore, my dear brothers and sisters, stand firm, have perseverance. Let nothing move you, persevere. Always give yourselves fully to the work of the Lord, persevere. Because you know that your labor in the Lord is not in vain. What we do know about our labor here on earth is that everything we do with these two hands, with our minds, with our bodies in other ways, will all perish unless it has spiritual implications. All the works of our hands will burn in an unquenchable fire. Mike builds beautiful cabinets. He'll probably weep on that day. Watching the work of his hands go up in smoke. And then he'll rejoice because he knows that the judgment is coming. We are baptized. John the Baptist said there was one coming after him when he was baptized in the Jordan. Jesus. Well, baptize, that is, baptize means to bring into relationship. We often talk about different forms of baptism, as cleansing, washing, different types of baptism, different methods that are used for baptizing. But the purpose of baptism in the Old Testament and the New is to bring us into a right relationship with God. The means that we use has varied greatly. Historically, in the old days, in the Old Testament, and in modern times, there's lots of different methods. But Jesus will bring us into relationship by baptizing us with the Holy Spirit and fire. Jesus sent his Holy Spirit to the apostles so that their work might be anointed, so that they would be able to prove through the actions that they did who Christ was, to establish his church. The fire that is spoken about in that verse is not as many came to preach. The fire that appeared as tongues on the day of Pentecost. The fire baptism is our baptism into eternity, when all of man's works are burned up and destroyed, except those things that have eternal consequence. You can find that throughout the book of Revelation, particularly in verse 20, the lake of fire, the unquenchable fire. That is the baptism by fire. We will see that happen, where all man's works perish, and we are made complete in the heavenly kingdom, seated with Christ. One awesome day, that's going to be. That's the final judgment. And until then, what must we do? We must persevere. We have a lot of biblical terms that highlight what perseverance is. You know, we live in an age of selfish, instant gratification. We watch what is done to our culture and to our world. It started a long time ago, and believe it or not, people like me who spent years in marketing and advertising are somewhat responsible for some of that. We came up with these clever jingles and expressions that we use. You deserve a break today, McDonald's. Just do it. Nike, right? Just do it. Don't hold back, just do it. We give out participation trophies to our kids because they played soccer. Not because they did well or they strove to do well, but just because they participated. Remember this one? Because I'm worth it? L'Oreal. Beautiful ladies in our TV commercials and stuff. We do all this stuff and then they're looking real beautiful on the TV screen. They go, L'Oreal. Because I'm worth it. See, this stuff is all about me. Mm-hmm. We call that I, me, mine, itis. This bud's for you. This bud's for you. This bud's for you. It's all about me. It's all about you and me. That instant gratification doesn't require that we persevere in very many ways, does it? It just requires that we crawl around and get enough money to go out, buy the bud, buy the perfume and the cosmetics, buy the tennis shoes, eat a hamburger. That's all that's needed for us to be gratified and fulfilled. Unfortunately, that has sunk so deep into the culture of modern times that that lie is causing confusion to our children and our grandchildren and their children. And they live life, unfortunately, a great many of them, looking for self-gratification, which we know is not rewarded. Those things that have eternal consequences are the things that are rewarded. You remember this one? He who dies with the most toys wins. Right? You drive around the neighborhood and you see this big 30-foot, not that it's wrong to have stuff. You see this big boat in somebody's driveway with a big four-wheel drive pickup truck with all the chrome, boom car, and fancy wheels, $2,000 worth of wheels and tires on that thing. And then behind that is another SUV with a trailer with a couple of quad runners on it and a couple of jet skis. Oh man, they got a lot of toys. That's not winning. That's not storing up treasures for ourselves in heaven. That's things that will perish. He who dies with the most toys wins. You guess what? He who dies with the most toys dies anyway. Sprite, 1994. Obey your thirst. Listen to what your body is telling you, because that's the most important thing. Have it your way, Burger King. Remember when you could only buy a Mac made a certain way? That's all changed. But originally, you could get a Mac one way. Now you can do that. But Burger King went out against that and said, have it your way. Says a sauce, cheese, lettuce, chicken, pickles, onions, and he says, have it your way. We bring good things to life, General Electric.
Yeah.
Fans, your lights,
your blenders, your
heaters and air conditioners. We bring good things to life. We will bless you with these things. It's all temporary stuff. And as much as we enjoy the comforts and convenience and the pleasure that those things bring to us, the unfortunate part about that mind-me-eyes thing is it redirects and refocuses too much of our energy away from things that really matter. Remember the Twin Towers?
Mm-hmm.
Of course you do. If you look at that, you see that video of that plane, 737, crashing into the side of that tower. It's about on scale with a hummingbird crashing into the side of your neck. One small little thing can cause our world to crumble. Before our eyes, instantly, 3,600 lives were taken that day, something around that number. It's all perishable. Only the things that are eternal have any real consequence to them. When I was a mechanic, I liked to weld, and I built tow bars, and I built trailer frames, and all this kind of stuff. And man, when I built something, it was a good thing. I know that those things are still going to be here after I'm gone. But in that day, they're going to perish. So we have to persevere. What will remain what we have done to build the kingdom of God in men's hearts, when we persevere, is fulfilling what God calls us to in Scripture. Godly perseverance fulfills a lot of Scripture. I'm going to give you just a few examples here. Godly perseverance fulfills obedience. It says in 2 Corinthians 10:5, bring all your thoughts into captivity. I don't do that so well sometimes. Many times I do it very well. I'm reminded by the Spirit that I'm out of balance with what's going on up here in my noggin. Bring all your thoughts into captivity. Persevere in that. And that is obedience. Faithfulness. Hebrews 10:23. Hold fast to the confession of our faith. How often do we have opportunity to share our faith or live out our faith? Then we slip. We get distracted. You know, Satan is the author of confusion. He's also the author of distraction. That's his unrelenting attack upon us. Perseverance is the overcoming power that we have by the Spirit to defeat those attacks of Satan. Be a servant. Be selfless. Matthew 20:26-27 tells us if we want to be great in God's kingdom, we need to become a servant of men. We need to have humility. And I remember Jimmy used to have a little sticker on the front of his drums that says others. Others are always more important than me. What a thought to build into our lives so powerfully that we don't even have to think about it. We just react to that. When we persevere in God's word, that's the kind of change that comes into our life. Humility, Ephesians 4:1-2. In gentleness, steadfastness, and long-suffering, bear with one another in love. If I don't have humility, I'm not going to bear with you about many things because I'm too important. I'm more important than you. Humility says that others are more important than yourself. So we bear with one another. I've seen examples of that throughout this fellowship for 6 or 7 years now, where we bear with one another. We are here today because you folks are so awesome at doing it. If Jesus were before you right now, I believe that he would commend you for your faithfulness and bearing with one another, for your steadfastness, another word for perseverance, for your long suffering, another word for perseverance. for staying together because we are united by the Spirit of Christ. When you pray and when you study God's Word, keep perseverance in mind. Just try that for a while. When you're praying, when you're studying, whatever it is you're looking at, any book of Scripture, any verse of Scripture, try and ask yourself a question. How does this apply if I persevere in this, what God is showing me in my life? There's elements of perseverance. I'm curious if you picked up on it. I listed them as patience, trust, steadfastness, and discovery. Discovery I have subsequently changed to dependence. But you'll see when we get there, let's both have the same idea. Did you get the acronym there? Anybody get it? Patience, trust, steadfastness, and dependence. PTSD. I didn't think about this when I wrote it down. I just wrote down what God was speaking to my heart through the scriptures. So we all want to have PTSD, right? Well, in this case, heck yeah, I'll take some PTSD. It's good for me. Patience is the first category. Put aside those things that distract from our calling. Hebrews 12:1 says, therefore we also, since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight and the sin which so easily ensnares us, and let us run with endurance the race that is set before us. If I were Jesus right now standing before you, I would say, well done, you have done this. Continue, persevere in it. I would say, you are remarkable. Your perseverance is your testimony. The way you stand for God, the way you uphold one another, the way you uphold the body, the way that you serve, your perseverance is your testimony. It is hard to find anything more powerful than a testimony to an unsaved world. When they see believers hanging together, working together, reaching out to help them in their times of trouble, they see Jesus because they persevere. There's lots of different kinds of perseverance. Lots of times when we have to persevere in all kinds of different things. Lay aside every weight. Mm-hmm. What are those weights? There are carnal desires, our sinful attitudes and behaviors. Sometimes there are possessions, and sometimes, hardest one of all, there are relationships. Sometimes we have to lay aside relationships. I know when Judy and I first came to the Lord, I had some friends that weren't real good for me as a new believer. And so I laid aside those relationships. And strangely, but not so strangely, some years later or some months later, as I began to grow as a Christian and Judy, we'd run into those people and we'd have some fellowship with them and they'd go, you're different. What changed? And you could tell them. Sometimes their impact on your life was so strong that you had to let those relationships go. Mm-hmm. I work with a man whose name is Ben in an automotive shop. And we did all kinds of wrong stuff together. But we had fun doing it. Sin is fun, isn't it? Some of it, especially before you believe, you don't have any conviction about it. You think you're not hurting anybody, but you're hurting this relationship. So what Benny and I did, we worked in an automotive shop. We'd work on cars, and Benny'd say, come for a test drive with me. I'm just doing this thing up. I'm going to see how it runs. So while we were out checking Benny's tune-up, we were tuning ourselves up. We were smoking pot. And then we come back to work, and our tolerant boss would just laugh at us and call us idiots because he knew we continue to work at a much slower pace, but we'd be happy. And so he let us get away with that. When Benny got saved, it was after Judy and I had got saved. Benny was under such conviction that he had to give up relationships. And he moved from Carson City, Nevada, to Dallas, Oregon, a distance of some probably 500 or more miles. I tried to reconnect with him after I found out he'd been saved. He was so worried because of our relationship that I would still be a bad influence on him. He didn't trust that I had been saved, and he wouldn't connect with me. That's the hardest one of all, to give up. But sometimes we have to give up relationships if they are a distraction from our relationship with God and other believers. It's hard enough. It's hard enough to do. Run with endurance. Don't grow weary of doing good. We all get tired and weary, right? Is that wrong? No. It's not wrong to get tired and weary. For physical beings, we have no choice in the matter. We need to do things to minimize and prevent weariness in order to persevere. We need to be continually refreshed. Remember that word recreation? Recreation. That's where it comes from. Sometimes we need to be recreated. We burn out. We get weary of doing good. You are really of no use to anybody, not ourselves or those around us. We're just burned out. We need recreation. Recreation. We need to be freshened. We need to set aside some of the weight that we're carrying. It may even be good weight. In fact, often it is pastors and worship leaders and people in ministries, missionaries, they burn out. Take time to be recreated by the Creator. Set aside time for recreation. It's okay. God knows. Jesus went through all of the things that we go through. He came almost fully man, right? Well, he ministered so heavily that when that lady touched the hem of his garment, he felt the power go out of him. How do you get that back? You need to be refreshed. So don't feel bad about spending time in prayer, spending time out on the water, or walking on the beach, or even just watching a movie or reading a book, just for the pure pleasure of it. It's all right. In fact, it's not only all right, it's good. Fellowship, worship, and personal time. All modes of refreshing so that we don't remain weary. We will grow weary, but we don't have to remain that way. I've given you a list of scriptures there, and one of them is James 1:4. But let patience have its perfect work, that you may be perfect and complete, lacking nothing. If we are obediently patient, then we will understand that we don't have to do everything perfect now. There needs to be time for restoration and recreation so that we are lacking nothing. You know, when we rush through things to try and get them finished because we feel like they need to be done, we make mistakes, don't we? And a lot of times those things just aren't that important. We call it OCD. Is that what it's called? Where we get fixated on solving a problem, doing this job or that job, and we neglect this relationship, or we neglect this heart-to-heart relationship. Being obediently patient should allow us to receive rest. We should be able to be refreshed without guilt. I'm encouraging you today to take that time to be refreshed. I know some people working very diligently, persevering at a very high level to accomplish something right here in this room. Terry and Carol Hall, their house was damaged by the hurricane. They have been striving with that relentlessly ever since. there in time. It takes some time to be refreshed. So whenever that time comes, there will be an appropriate time. God will give you that time to be refreshed and to be restored. Take it when you see it coming. Don't neglect yourselves. Ecclesiastes 7:8-9. The end of a thing is better than its beginning. Yeah, start working out and you are going weights and you'll realize that the end of people is way better than the beginning. Do not hasten your spirit to be angry, for anger rests or resides in or inhabits the bosom of fools. We have no time to be angry. That is a theft of our time, our energy, and our spiritual resources. If you get angry, dispense with it as quickly as you possibly can. A proud spirit is a driven spirit. When you see that your way, remember the self-gratification thing, becomes so significant that your pride swells up and you have to have your way, your ego has made you a driven spirit. You neglect the physical, emotional, and spiritual needs of ourselves and others when you let that happen. Don't have a proud spirit, have a humble spirit. That's what we're called to. A proud spirit drives us to respond to the world around us according to how the world has treated me. You guys did so awesome with not doing that over this thing that happened to this body recently. And everybody wrestled with it, of course. But you did not let that take dominion over this relationship or this relationship. Mm-hmm. That's powerful testimony. Mm-hmm. Trust, same part of PTSD. Our trust in God and not in ourselves must be ever present. Hebrews 10:23, let us hold fast to the confession of our hope without wavering. For he who promised is faithful. Hold fast. Persevere to the confession of our faith. Remember that our faith is where our strength comes from. It's our belief system that upholds us through God's word, that strengthens us for our day-to-day needs for getting along. Don't waver in that. Persevere in it. We must return to God when we realize we have not included him in our passions, plans, and activities. I remember somebody said once, if you want to make God laugh, tell him what your plans are. These are often quite different. You know, I've experienced that. I'm sure most of you have experienced that too. And I've gone out with great plans about what I was going to do. I won't tell you the long story, but I had this massive plan to get my dad saved before he died. He was in the hospital after 3 successive strokes, and we knew he was going to go. And I stayed up for three nights, concocted this great plan. By golly, I'm going to get it saved if nobody else can. I'm going to make this happen. I had my plan. And I went to see him in the hospital, and God said, no. That plan that you worked on for 3 days, chuck it. It's not what I wanted to do. So my dad got saved that day. Because I listened. Because I put God before my own plans and my own activities. My dad heard. God is faithful. Jesus understands our wavering, right? He didn't waver. He took time to separate himself, to go along and pray. He took time to be refreshed. He understands our wavering because he felt the same temptations that we feel. He came fully man and fully God. You know what we go through. He was tempted as we are tempted. He is our advocate with the Father. He is always true to his word. God is faithful. 1 Peter 2:1-5. Therefore, laying aside all malice, all deceit, all hypocrisy, envy, and all evil speaking, as newborn babes desire the pure milk of the word, that you may grow thereby. If indeed you have tasted that the Lord is gracious. Coming to him as a living stone, rejected indeed by men, but chosen by God, precious, you also, as living stones, are being built up a spiritual house, a holy priesthood, to offer up spiritual sacrifices acceptable to God through Jesus Christ. Persevere. That is our strength. And that is what we're called to. Our spiritual sacrifices to God come when we serve man and worship God. And who would be great than the servant of the Lord? Steadfastness. Hold firm to the things that we have learned. Do not waver. 1 Corinthians, we come full circle, 15:58, that we read earlier. Therefore, my beloved brother, be steadfast, immovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, knowing that your labor is not in vain. The world, meaning Satan, can and does bully us with distraction, with an overburden of work, with all of those things that we just listed in Scripture there. Deceitfulness and all of the other things that come our way that would distract us from the life that God has planned and made for us. Satan's a bully. And he's a relentless bully. And his minions are relentless bullies. We must persevere and be steadfast. If we do and if we are, we have strength in the Lord that's insubmersible. Use our energy to abound in the work of the Lord. When we are distracted, we are not moving forward. Chris talked about that early in the book of James, about not being distracted, about the only way to move forward is when we are not distracted by these things, our angers, our passions, our frustrations. Our labors are not in vain. Mike and I worked for five, 6 hours a day for several weeks on that stupid boat that's sitting out there. We persevered, and we did not get distracted. The ultimate outcome of that is that thing that's going to burn up and perish out there. Right now, it's running real good. It's fun. We had a great time with it. But at my time, persevered with me as brother to brother, I would quit long before I did, and that thing would be back out in the backyard. But we persevered, but the important part of that was not that we resurrected that old world. It's going to burn up. Our remains and share and eternal years of life, birth, and health. Out of that time. It cannot be diminished unless we make bad decisions that allow that. Unless we let sin get in between us. This is an eternal thing that we have. It's called relationship. Persevere in those things. 2 Timothy 2:15. Be diligent to present yourself approved to God, a worker who does not need to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. You know, we stand before God every day, not because he calls us up to stand before him, but God is omnipresent. He's here in this room now. He's there in the bedroom when I wake up in the morning. He's there in the office when I'm sitting at my computer. He's out there in the yard when I'm not pulling the weeds that need to be pulled. He's out there in the garage when Mike and I are working on the boat. He's with you guys when we're playing music and loving on one another. He's omnipresent. He's around us all the time. When we persevere, God looks at our lives and says, well done. I love that expression. Hebrews 3:14. For we have become partakers with Christ if we hold the beginning of our confidence steadfast to the end, if we persevere. At salvation, we had a full confidence and assurance of who Christ was, right? We were undistracted in that day for however long that freshness of our relationship, our marriage to Christ landed. For however long that lasted, for however long that honeymoon existed, we had full confidence and complete assurance of who we were in Christ. And nothing would distract us from that. I drove home from Southern California at 400 miles in my pickup truck. And the passage of time was like nothing. Because I was so focused on Jesus and on Christ and on a new relationship with Him. He's telling us here, hold to the beginning of our confidence, steadfast to the end. The beginning of our confidence, the newness of that day, hold fast to that every day. The honeymoon tends to kind of perish a little bit. But the essence of the honeymoon is still there. The love that you have for your spouse, the love that you have for Jesus, hold fast to that every day. He's on your presence. He feels it. He knows it when you do. Discovering dependence. God is faithful and His Word has preserved for us the timeless truths that we can learn to use in our walk. John 8:31. When Jesus said to those Jews who believed Him, "If you abide in My Word, you are My disciples indeed, and you shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free." That is a powerful statement. This is what our kids are not getting. Our children and our grandchildren are not getting enough. If they have godly parents, if they have godly mentors, they're getting it. But by and large, the majority of them aren't getting it. If you're like me and a lot of people I talk to, you watch the younger generations of our day, and you wonder, like our parents wondered about us, what's going to become of them? They're all into walking around with their cell phones. And they never even talk to one another. They don't get together. Well, I'm going to the beach today. Well, I'm going to work out at the ranch today. Well, let's get together on our cell phones. That's the total of relationship for a lot of those folks. It's not life-sustaining, not life-supporting. The truth abides in Jesus' words. Eric Helms will be here, I believe, next Sunday. I saw a deal on Fox News the other day. I don't recognize this name. Martinsburg, West Virginia. They have what's called up there the Martinsburg Initiative. We saw it on Fox News, and the sheriff's office and several other organizations up there have gotten together and decided, you know, we need to combat this opiate addiction that our youth have. America, we're so much about me, right? America thinks that we shouldn't have pain. So we drug ourselves. We do all kinds of things so that we don't feel pain. Do you think maybe that a certain amount of pain was God-given with a purpose? Of course it was. You know, if I drug myself up so much that I forget that I have two herniated discs in my low back, I'm going to hurt myself really bad. We have an addiction in this country that has multiplied, tripled in the last decade, the opioid addiction, because doctors are prescribing that to relieve pain. Up in West Virginia, their youth have the highest rate of that anywhere in the country. At Martinsburg. So they started this Martinsburg Initiative to raise up those kids and give them a hope and give them something to look forward to so that they turn away from that me thing. See, those addictions are all about me, aren't they? Addictions to anything, all about self-gratification and biological needs that we decide that we're going to feed. They're hard to break. These opioid addictions come because these kids have problems to begin with. Eric Helms' job, his ministry is called Driven to Encourage Kids with the Truth of Jesus. So when I saw that thing on the news, on Fox News, about that organization, I immediately sent word to Chris, who immediately forwarded that to Eric, except about our Eric's thing. And Eric responded to me and he says, that's my wheelhouse. I'll do what I can. Those kids need to hear the truth. We have the truth. We need to share the truth. You know, there's kids all around us. Some of them are our own age. But you don't grow up until you have Jesus. You just grow old without Jesus. So everybody around us who's unsaved is technically a kid. Because they don't have the truth. Sometimes I think how nice it would be to stand out there across from the high school with the sign that said, come here for the truth. Because they're not getting it in their schools. They're not getting it from the media. And so these addictions continue. So I don't know what's going to happen with Eric. But if we persevere in the things that we believe, we become equipped to share those things with people who don't have that. To share Jesus. Rather than bind us, the truth makes us free. See, lies bind us up. We have this thing in school we call evolution. Mike and I were talking about this driving around the other day. If you tell a lie often enough, eventually it becomes the truth. Not because it's true, but it's because the other side of the issue or story is never heard. So that's all people know. So kids in school, you know, they get the evolution thing. They don't get another side of the story. They don't get a creation picture. Because nobody's persevering in our schools and sharing that. Because parents aren't persevering in sharing the truth with their kids. So, if you hear a lie often enough, it becomes true. Politicians thrive on that, right? I mean, they'll tell a lie so many times that even though you know it's a lie, pretty soon they're gone.
That's right.
And so you check the box on that. We need to know the truth. We need to persevere in the things that we know in the light of God. Psalms 25:5. Show me your ways, O Lord. Teach me your paths. Lead me in your truth and teach me. For you are the God of my salvation. On you I wait upon the day. Persevere in waiting upon the Lord. Sometimes it doesn't feel like his presence. 2 Timothy 3:16 and 17. All scripture is given by inspiration of God, who is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness, that the man of God may be complete, thoroughly equipped for every good work. See, we don't need a lot of peripheral stuff to be equipped to do good works. You guys already have that. It's in your hearts. It's in your head. You walk it, you live it every day. We see it as we're together. Fellowship. It's an awesome thing to have that truth. We should be jealous for the minds and hearts of people who don't have that truth. We should be jealous for them because God is jealous for them. God's word is in our hearts and minds and it gives us the power to persevere. Perseverance is our crown and does not disappoint. Romans 5:1-5. Therefore, having been justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom also we have access by faith into this grace in which we stand and rejoice in hope of the glory of God. And not only that, but we also glory in tribulations.
Really?
Yeah, really. We studied that in James. Again, we consider it all joy. Right? Because it's for the building up of our faith. Because without the building up of our faith, we can't persevere. Mm-hmm. See how that thread flows all through there? It's so neat. And perseverance, character, and character hope. Now, hope does not disappoint because the love of God has been poured out in our hearts by the Holy Spirit who was given to us. Folks, take that word, perseverance, in your Bible somewhere. Because it's hard to persevere. We're under constant attack. Let God teach you how to persevere. His word has all the tools and equipment. We just read out Timothy. Everything we need to know, persevere, is there. Don't confuse yourself. Leave the rest. and do it. Don't feel guilty. Take a break. I want to encourage you also, consider, persevere in being with this body. This body is going to have losses, snow birds, and other folks leaving during the summer months. Persevere in coming together and encourage others who may not be here today, who are part of this body. Encourage them to persevere in coming, because this is what happens if we don't persevere. Then Del Nero's leaving. And Judy and I leave. Janice and Bob leave. Your number starts to look kind of small, right?
Mm-hmm.
And you get a little bit discouraged. Mm-hmm. You're like, oh man, what's happening? This isn't cool. I don't like this. Instead, thank goodness. I can't wait till they come back so we can see what we've done.
Yep.
Right? So they can see how the body has grown, so they can see that we're closer than ever.
It's fun to come back and see that.
It is.
It's fun to rejoice.
So do that. Persevere in getting together, and persevere in getting hold of those people who don't persevere and encourage them to do so. You don't got to beat each other up. You got to love each other into the body, right? Man, we're missing you. Man, we sure love to see you here. You know, we really need you here. You build us up. You make a difference. Persevere. Let's pray.